Did you know you can own a warehouse leased to Amazon? Amazon, like many other large companies, often lease properties instead of owning them. And if you don't want to invest the tens or hundreds of millions of dollars it would take to buy the physical warehouses, you can own shares in publicly traded companies, which does this on your behalf. This video is an introduction to industrial real estate investment trusts. And with the e-commerce explosion bringing a considerable amount of attention to these massive warehouses, there's an increased investor appetite for these types of investments. I'm going to break this video down into the following topics. Timestamps are in the description if you want to jump to any section in particular as well. So what is a REIT? REITs were enacted into legislation in 1960, giving everyday investors the ability to participate in institutional-grade investment properties, either on the property side or on the mortgage side. Before REITs came along, investing in these large commercial properties was simply unobtainable for the average investor. There are private REITs and public non-listed REITs, but the most popular ones are listed on major exchanges. And to that extent, an investor can purchase shares in these REITs the same way they could purchase shares in other publicly traded companies. The best way I've heard this described is that you're buying into a fractional ownership of a company. In the case of REITs, this means you're indirectly getting ownership of their entire portfolio of properties. And investors have flocked to REITs in astonishing numbers, driving the aggregate market caps of US REITs over $1 trillion. As the REIT industry has grown, many of them have realized they could be more efficient by focusing on one asset class. You'll still find diversified REITs that own properties in multiple asset classes, but it's increasingly becoming more common to see pure play REITs, which focus on one type of property, such as office, retail, industrial, hospitality, lodging, self-storage, or even data centers. Industrial real estate is the focus of my channel, so if you've watched any of my other videos, this next section will be an overview of what I've talked about extensively. Industrial real estate is a broad term, so the first thing I recommend is breaking it down into the following subcategories: warehousing, manufacturing, and flex properties. Warehousing properties are the large distribution centers designed to store goods or materials. It also includes warehouses which store products for months or even years, as well as properties that might only hold product for days or perhaps even hours. These properties have been increasing in demand lately, driving vacancy rate to record low levels in some hot markets. The other type is manufacturing properties, and these are buildings designed for the manufacturing, assembly, or production of raw, semi-raw, or finished goods. These can be elaborate operations, such as the Boeing factory, or small, simple buildings that manufacture consumer goods. There's surely a small operation out there which makes Boeing model planes for kids and some adults. The other main category is flex, which is sort of a catch-all term to include all the industrial properties that aren't specifically designed for warehousing or manufacturing. This could include lab space, bottle depots, showroom space, and dozens of other examples, really. Check out this video up here if you want to dive into the topic deeper. You can already see why this is important. If you want to invest in an industrial REIT, it's prudent to know what segment of the industrial market they cater to. It's a simple fact that e-commerce is not likely compatible inside a manufacturing property, and vice versa. You'll see as we get into the REITs, most of them clearly identify what type of properties they focus on. My first point might not be overly relevant to you if you're only planning on investing in a REIT, but if you already own physical industrial real estate or are planning to in the future, this next point is important. One trait that I've noticed in all successful industrial real estate investors is they all have their fingers on the pulse of the market. That's why I like to think a huge benefit of owning a REIT is you get access to a ton of valuable market information. In addition to putting out quarterly earnings reports and conference calls, these companies often provide helpful insights into their investment strategies and where they see opportunities. In other words, owning a handful of REITs is a fast-track way to gain market intelligence. Now, to be fair, you could follow along without owning anything, but I believe it's human nature to be more engaged if you have some skin in the game. And the beautiful part is that there aren't any financial barriers to get started. You could buy $100 worth of stock or $1 million, and you have near instant liquidity if you decide you want to sell. Investing in a REIT also means you don't have to actively manage any of the properties. The REIT does this on behalf of all investors, and to be a REIT in the first place, companies have to pay out 90% of their taxable income. Provided there isn't some shock to the system, like some office and retail REITs experienced this past year, investors can earn regular dividends and share in any appreciation of the stock price. And since the movement of a stock price is a derivative of the underlying performance of the company, as a shareholder, you can participate in the underlying value of the properties going up, but you also share the risk of it potentially going down. And that leads to the drawbacks of owning a REIT. There's a nearly exhaustive list that we could explore, but I'm only going to focus on the main ones from my perspective. First, you can't use leverage the same way you could investing in physical real estate. You could use margin, but that's a much riskier endeavor in the stock market versus the real estate market. Physical real estate can also offer considerable tax benefits that come from depreciation or 1031 tax exchanges, and you lose those as a REIT investor. If you've followed REITs extensively over the past year, you'll also know that some non-industrial REITs temporarily suspended dividends altogether. Naturally, there are unlimited potential risks to the market, the economy, and even each respective REIT. If you want more danger signs to watch out for, check out this video from Nick. It'd be virtually impossible to try analyzing property-level details for REITs that can own dozens, hundreds, or thousands of properties. Most REITs will break down what type of property they own, so the first step I'd take is to determine whether their focus is on warehousing, manufacturing, or a combination of both. For example, Prologis, the largest industrial REIT in the US, owns primarily warehouses designed for distribution and logistics. Most REITs will also share high-level property information, such as where the properties are located and when leases are coming up for renewal. You can appreciate that having a high percentage of leases coming up in 1 year versus 10 years can create challenges or opportunities. It's a challenge if the market is softening, it's an opportunity if the market is strengthening. Moving on to the financial metrics, you'll need to be aware that REITs track their performance differently than C corporations. While all publicly traded companies have strict requirements when reporting, the REIT industry introduced new measurements back in the 90s, which has since been recognized by the SEC to include in their supplementary earnings reports. If you look up any REIT, you'll see the metrics you're already familiar with. But instead of focusing on earnings, the REIT industry uses a term known as funds from operation, or FFO. The biggest difference between earnings and FFO is how depreciation is accounted for. Under a traditional corporation, an asset is depreciated over its useful life. REITs, conversely, have successfully argued that real estate often does not depreciate and therefore should not be factored into these earnings calculations. NAREIT, the industry association for REITs, has a white paper on FFO and it looks quite daunting. What makes it even more confusing, many different REITs have come up with their own unique way of calculating FFO. So you might hear the term normalized FFO, core FFO, operating FFO, and some companies don't even disclose these calculations. If you're feeling confused, let's break this down to make it really simple. Net income, add back in the depreciation, subtract gains or losses from real estate sales, add or subtract adjustments for partnerships and joint ventures, and that will equal your FFO. The biggest adjustment is likely going to be depreciation, unless of course a REIT was heavily active in acquisitions or dispositions. If we take FFO, we can make a few more adjustments to make an equally important number called adjusted funds from operations, or AFFO. There's no standardized definition of AFFO, and REITs might do it all a little bit differently, but here's an example of what the calculation could look like. FFO, subtract tenant improvements, subtract straight-line rents, which is an average rental rate over the term of the lease, subtract leasing commissions and building improvements, and that will give you the adjusted funds from operations, or AFFO. AFFO is a measure of the company's ability to pay obligations and dividends. So you might also hear it referred to as the cash available for distributions or funds available for distributions. So let's summarize this. FFO is a measure of earnings, and AFFO is a measure of cash flow. This is important because instead of tracking earnings growth, the REIT industry tracks FFO growth and AFFO growth. A closely related measure to track growth is borrowed from the retail industry called same store. Just like a retailer tracks how much each individual store gains or loses, a REIT tracks growth or declines in individual properties. Naturally, I'm just scratching the surface here. So if you're looking to invest in REITs and want to study it further, there's an excellent standalone course put on by NYU. Or for a cheaper option, this is a great book too. I'll put links in the description for both. We've already covered a lot of material here, so before I go into the outlook, I have to emphasize that I'm not an investment advisor, so do your own due diligence before making any investment decisions. And if you're getting any value from this video, please smash that like button. And if you don't like this stuff, crush that dislike button, and I'll know I need to change things up. But back to the outlook. I think it's important to delineate the industrial real estate market from the stock market. On the real estate side, I believe industrial will outperform the other asset classes for the foreseeable future. E-commerce is going to continue growing, and companies will increasingly require more warehouse space to accommodate it all. And there's plenty in the news about how little supply is available and how demand is heating up. So I'm very bullish on the long-term prospects of physical industrial real estate. I also subscribe to the notion that a REIT price will rise over time in accordance with improvements in cash flow. So I plan on holding the REITs I have, which right now is Prologis, Duke Realty, and Stag Industrial, at least for the foreseeable future. It's worth highlighting, though, that all three of these are at or near all-time highs, so the market is clearly pricing in some aggressive growth expectations as well. That's why I think it's necessary to separate the long-term real estate market from the short-term stock market. Conceivably, there are an infinite amount of factors that could cause the market to falter. So in the short run, there could still be a lot of volatility, and stock prices could move independently of the underlying value of the real estate itself. In the long run, we also have to worry about overbuilding and the accompanying set of issues that would come with that. Whether it's a short or long run, the industrial real estate market is going to be fascinating to watch, and that's what my channel is exclusively about. So if you want to come along for the ride, please consider subscribing. Thanks for watching. Catch you in the next video. Subtract. Why am I saying subtract? Did you know you can own an...